Blackstone Audio presents The History of Now by Daniel Klein. For Frieka. If we take eternity to mean not infinite temporal duration, but timelessness, then eternal life belongs to those who live in the present. Ludwig Wittgenstein. Prologue. Although at the time there were no laws shielding the identities of juvenile offenders, the name of the teenager who set the Melville block ablaze in 1892 is unrecorded and long forgotten. What is known is that the boys subsequently torched the Macaulay Cigar Company on Railroad Street and a stable in Housatonic before finally being caught and sent off to reform school in Boston. Still, like the unknown soldier entombed in Arlington Cemetery, the unknown pyromaniac of Grandville, Massachusetts, is invoked here with something akin to honor, a sort of nefarious patron saint, the boy who single-handedly ignited Grandville's glorious renaissance. The names of the four men comprising the business syndicate that resurrected the Melville block are known to anyone who inspects the granite cornerstone on the corner of Melville and Main Streets today. J.M. Cosgrove, a New York City industrialist who summered in his family's cottage in nearby Lenox. Isaiah Smith, a Yale friend of Cosgrove who was in banking. William W. Watts, an English-born land speculator. And Hans Quirinus de Vries, the sole Grandville native in the mix, and the former owner of DeVries Clothiers, which went up in flames with the rest of the original wooden building. The four met every Sunday afternoon, except Easter, from March through November of 1893, to discuss their vision for the new structure. Usually these meetings took place in Cosgrove's stove-heated study in his 20-room cottage known as Sway Lodge, but at least three times they convened at DeVries's far more modest digs, his six-room Dutch colonial on Upper Mountain Road in Granville. If that setting was less grand than Sway Lodge, the refreshments surpassed anything Cosgrove's cook ever offered, with the possible exception of Cosgrove's imported brandy. That is because Hans DeVries's wife, Françoise, set the table. French-Canadian by birth and mother tongue, Françoise was a supremely talented and painstaking cook. The Melville group was welcomed with a tub of raw oysters, followed by a dish of fried smelts dabbed with aioli, next, sweetbread pâtés and rice croquettes. At their second meeting in the DeVries home, although it took place in the middle of a winter afternoon hours before supper time, Françoise presented the assembled planners with a half-dozen quail with truffles. As it turned out, the petite, dark-eyed Françoise was a hostess with an agenda. She fervently wanted the new, fire-resistant, Pennsylvania-pressed Roman brick and white marble building to include a theater, not merely some social hall cum proscenium, but a grand theater, one that would rival Le Monument National on the Rue Saint-Laurent in Quebec, a theater she had only been inside once, but which had made an indelible impression on her. Of course, Françoise left it to her husband to offer this proposal, yet each time he brought it up, she would miraculously appear from the kitchen, hoisting a plate of mouth-watering delicacies. At first, Cosgrove, Smith, and Watts would hear none of it. A theater was an investment sinkhole. Granville had fewer than 6,000 citizens, at least half of whom could not afford a plate of oysters, let alone a theater ticket. Perhaps an especially popular theatrical could draw an audience from Stockbridge and Lenox, maybe even from Albany. But how often might that happen? Once a year? Twice? Shops, offices, taverns, a small hotel? Cubic foot by foot, that's where the profit on our $200,000 investment lies. Enter Françoise DeVries with a plate of steaming asparagus blanketed with nutmeg.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.